So good morning, everybody. Good morning, good day, or good afternoon at certain places, depending on where you're at or where you're hailing from. Welcome to our second virtual partner session. My name is Morales Isaias, representing IBIS Management in this case. And in line with our, we call it the IBIS 2020 anniversary. Yeah, our 20th years in business. We have been celebrating that as of last week. We kicked that off with a virtual user group session, and we announced basically the progression of these type of sessions, so like our partner sessions. And in this case, the Entrust partner session that will be, as you know, IBIS Management is a business partner or a Caribbean representative of Entrust for many years. I think for over 13 or almost 14 years now, I guess. And as such, we have been successful to to do a number of implementations of Entrust solutions here and there. We have a number of clients across the region that utilize the Entrust services, our services and the Entrust solutions. So I will just move over to a quick introduction. In this case, we will not spend too much time on the IBIS side, right? But we will more focus on the Entrust side. So I will then go over to the introduction. Let me just make sure that I see it already. Oh, something. So I see that I actually miss a sheet where I actually wanted to let you know that, because most of you all that know us with our Entrust solutions know that Entrust is we used to be known as Entrust Data Card, and I had a nice sheet up there to show you in terms of the change from the branding in terms of Entrust Data Card to Entrust. However, I think it's more interesting to listen to the two specialists in this area. Our business partners will actually guide you through this session, and this session is actually called the Securing a World in Motion, working from home securely, and that is in about goes off to multi-factor authentication for your remote workforce, right? So our speakers for today will be Dalia Abreu. Dalia hails out of Canada, and Dalia is the Enterprise Sales Director at Entrust for the Caribbean and Latin America. And we also have Ricardo Godoy, originally hails out of Mexico, but I think at this point out of Colombia. And he's a Senior Technical Sales Consultant for the Caribbean region as well as Latin. So basically, without further ado, I just want to hand over to them. I'm sure that they are ready and able to take on. So in this case, I will hand over the sharing and mute my mics for both Dalia as well as Ricardo to take over.
Excellent. So we'll start. So Morales, I just wanted to thank you very much for organizing this. Happy Friday to everyone. It's a real pleasure to share this this hour with all of you and to share with you some information about Entrust and the important role we actually play in securing a world in motion. So today we're going to take a deeper look into how we can help enable employees to work securely from home, or to essentially work securely from anywhere in the world for that matter. So on the next slide, I just want to spend just a minute or two talking to you a little bit about who we are as a company. So Entrust is a global company. We've been in the business of enabling trust for more than 50 years, and we're really all about digital trust, creating digital identities, securing electronic transactions, and securing data at rest and in transit. So an interesting statistic at the bottom is that 80% of all financial cards issued in the world today are actually personalized with our card issuance solution in our printers. In terms of revenue, we do almost $1 billion a year. We have approximately over 2,500 colleagues around the world serving customers in about 150 countries. And where we do not have offices, such as in the Caribbean, which is a shame, but we are well represented by our partners, such as IBIS in the Caribbean region. We are well trusted by some of the world's largest governments, financial institutions, and corporations to handle their most sensitive interactions. And some of those examples are, for instance, SWIFT. SWIFT uses our PKI to encrypt their transactions. And NATO and the UN, they actually use our solutions as well to create really strong employee credentials. And to talk about the Caribbean, we have St. Kitts Island, Barbados, Island of Dominica, and Jamaica. All those Caribbean governments are using our solutions to protect their borders and as well to create really strong citizen credentials, digital citizens credentials as well. So as you can see, we really do have a very strong presence in the world. We have a prestigious reputation and brand, and this really gives us credibility in the market. So the next slide is really about our portfolio. It's a little bit extensive. So in essence, what I really just wanted to communicate here is that our solutions help enable transformation. We deliver trusted payments, trusted identities, and trusted data. And our solutions can either be deployed as an on-premise solution, or it could be deployed as a cloud-based solution. So the first three hexagons at the bottom, really quickly, is really centered around that physical identity. So we have access control systems, central issuance systems for those bureaus who issue EMV cards, and we have the instant issuance systems, which basically means, we give banks the power to issue either a debit card or a credit card instantly within their own branch, as opposed to having a customer wait a few weeks to get a replacement card. The remaining five hexagons really center around creating and securing a digital identity. And so we offer HSMs, we offer public key infrastructure, which is the software that issues digital certificates. We have Internet of Things solutions, so IoT, so we can issue devices, we can issue certificates for devices and any type of devices. And we have identity and access management solution, which in other words is also known as authentication. And that's the solution that we're going to concentrate today. And the last one really is all about digital certificates and different types of digital certificates for your web servers. And we also have digital signing solutions as well. So the next slide really encapsulates what we are all about. At Entrust, we're really all about creating that trusted ID that could either be a physical ID or it could be a digital ID. And we're really going to focus today on that digital ID. So all types of institutions, verticals, really can use or need to create trusted IDs on the next slide. And financial institutions, banks, they need to create digital IDs for their consumers so their consumers can do online banking transactions securely. Digital IDs also apply to governments who need to bring secure services online for their citizens and to secure their borders with physical IDs. And then even enterprises, they need to create strong, secure employee credential IDs, which then allow those employees to access corporate applications and corporate data. So now we're actually going to move into the digital market and what that looks like today. So on the next slide, there's a little cartoon image, and both Ricardo and I found this, and we thought that this really encapsulates what the year 2020 is all about. I don't think anybody was expecting a global pandemic. And, you know, just to tell you all a story, before COVID hit, me and Ricardo were traveling, you know, we're visiting our customers, and all our customers were saying the same thing. They were all saying, oh, you know, we have a digital transformation plan to digitally transform our business within 2 to 5 years. And, you know, Ricardo and I were like, that's fantastic. We can help you achieve that. Our last trip was February. We came back in March, COVID hit, everything basically shut down. And those same customers that we visited prior to COVID, you know, called me up and said, Dalia, you know, that digital transformation project that we had for the next 2 to 5 years, well, now we really need to achieve that within the next 2 to 5 months. And this was really the reality. When COVID hit, businesses were forced to make major structural changes, all due to the social distancing. So banks, healthcare, government, enterprises, they all had to adapt to new technologies to remove that in-person interaction and to really encourage a more distributed workforce. So I don't know about you, but I've had a few doctor's appointments since COVID hit, and they were all done by telehealth. So it was either a Zoom call with my doctor, or it was just a phone call. Businesses are now really doing majority is web conferences with Zoom. We're seeing an increased demand for digital document signing to really replace that in-person signing of documents. So banks, for instance, need to allow their new customers to be able to remotely digitally sign contracts for a new loan or to open up a new bank account, for instance. And also on the banking side, banks had to implement new technologies to be able to onboard new customers, allowing customers to open up an account remotely as opposed to actually physically going into the branch. And then we've seen enterprises, and Entrust was one of them. Entrust shut down their office in March, and only those that were deemed essential workers were actually allowed into the building. And today our businesses, our offices still remain closed, and the majority of us are all working from home remotely. So the choice really, as the cartoon image depicts, it was either you adapt quickly to the digital technology and you survived throughout COVID, or you basically shut down your doors for good. And unfortunately, I've seen a lot of businesses in where I live in Ottawa actually shut down their doors, and they went out of business. So the next slide is really about the market dynamics due to COVID. And so organizations, they really had to move fast to implement a new digital solution. And working from home became the new normal. And I'm still working from home, and likely the Entrust employees will likely work from home until mid of next year. And because businesses had to move fast and implement a new solution really quickly, they really looked to the cloud, because the cloud allowed organizations to get up and running in a number of days, as opposed to implementing a solution on-prem and getting into production in a matter of months. And by going digital, organizations still have to comply with local regulations. So banks, for instance, they need to comply with multi-factor authentication for their online banking customers. And then the healthcare, for instance, they too have to comply with certain regulations, such as HIPAA, for instance, in the US and in Canada. So on the flip side of this, unfortunately, we've seen cyber criminals taking advantage of the pandemic to perpetrate attacks on different type of organizations. And unfortunately, COVID really created that perfect storm for fraud. And so since COVID hit, we have seen an uptake on banks being hit with ransomware. And we've seen reports coming out from the World Health Organization, actually. And they said that since they declared a pandemic, they reported a fivefold increase in cyber attacks on their own systems, which really blows my mind that cyber criminals would actually attack the World Health Organization. And then the Federal Trade Commission agency in the U.S. Stated in one of their reports that since COVID hit, 36,000 overall consumer reports of fraud were reported that totaled about 25 million in fraud loss. And this does not even include corporate fraud. So that 25 million is probably much, much, much higher than what the report actually states. So we're going to move on and we're going to talk about the identity. So next slide, please, Ricardo. Thank you. So the identity for the enterprise, and these are some really alarming statistics. 62% of employee identities, they still rely on legacy approaches such as username and password to actually access company resources. And we all know that this really today is not a reliable identity in today's digital world. Not only is it not secure, but it actually provides a very negative user experience for most employees, because most employees on average have to manage about 5 to 10 different credentials for different corporate applications. And that can be quite frustrating. And a lot of companies suffer from security breaches. Username and passwords, like I said, they're easily obtainable through simple attacks such as key logging techniques or a simple phishing attack. So on the next slide, there's a lot of focus today on workforce identity. And, you know, just to let you know that there have been some really big companies in the past that experienced breaches due to weak employee credentials, such as Sony and Marriott, and another one was Equifax. And because of this, a lot of companies are moving towards credential-based authentication, which essentially means a really strong, high-assurance credential, either a digital certificate or either, you know, a strong second factor of authentication. And Gartner, one of the leading analysts in the world today, in one of their reports, they stated that by the year 2020, most enterprises will actually implement a passwordless authentication method for their employees. And this is really the trend today, and there's a lot of buzz around passwordless authentication. And Ricardo's gonna do some demos and he's gonna talk to you a little bit more in depth about what that all means. And then IT departments also are embracing zero trust, which means, you know, even if you're working within the organization, you still have to prove who you say you are before you access internal company applications or databases. So on the next slide right here. So some of the best practices to implement workforce identities are really a few suggestions. You know, ditch the password. We've seen that it's not secure enough. Go high assurance with credential-based authentication or multi-factor authentication. Look to the cloud to make your implementation a lot faster and a lot easier and better return on investment. Verify your workers' identities by using second-factor authentication or a strong credential-based solution. And for those companies who embrace bring your own device to work, you know, you can also check the device reputation of those employees to to make sure that those devices haven't been rooted or jailbroken, or they're not associated with any fraudulent activity in the past. And you know, you can also do contextual analysis and step-up authentication. And what that means really is check the IP address that the employee is using to access the VPN, for example. Is that IP address coming from somewhere in the Caribbean? Or is that IP address coming from Russia or China? And if it does, then you know, there's potential risks there. And choose a solution that really addresses low friction for those employees. A solution that allows employees to sign in once to their desktop. And by signing in once, they're automatically authenticated to all the other corporate applications and to cloud-based applications as well. So my last slide is the next one. And if I can leave you with three takeaways, it would be, you know, digital transformation is here, and the pandemic really pushed digital transformation, and it's really transforming the way people interact with enterprises, governments, financial institutions, and even healthcare. Number two, security and trust are really critical if you have a digital transformation plan. If you don't have secure identities, then obviously there's no trust in your digital platform. And then three, as leaders in securing identities and data, Entrust can really help you enable and achieve your digital transformation. So now I'm going to pass it to Ricardo, and he's really going to show you how to create some of those strong employee credentials that would allow an employee to work securely from within the organization and as well from outside of the organization.
Thank you, Dahlia. Before we hand it over to Ricardo, I just want to remind everybody that you're free to address your questions because we have a few other persons that joined. So we don't have this interactive question and answer session, but at the bottom of your screen, I think you have a Q&A button where you could address your questions or even your comments, remarks, concerns, and so on, and we will then get into that, right? So, Dahlia, are you ready for questions, or are you taking them at the end?
It's up to you, Morales. Both Ricardo and I are good to go if you want to do them now and yes, do the rest later.
Okay, we'll do the rest later, but since you are actually concluding your section, you started off with, for instance, I think you're mentioning in terms of the solution, in terms of border control, and you mentioned a few of our jurisdictions where we have our clients, but could you probably indicate a little more what role Entrust plays with that?
Sure, absolutely. So for instance, there's a few islands in the Caribbean. I just don't have them all at the top of my mind, but St. Kitts, Island of Dominica, for instance, they are using, and there's a few other islands as well.
Barbados and
Bermuda. Yeah, so they're specifically using our PKI technology so they can issue e-passports. And what an e-passport is that it has a chip. And that chip will contain the same information that's printed on the passport. So if there's any modification on the actual passport, the inspector at the border, he will be able to see the information on the chip and to see if it matches the information printed on the actual passport. If it doesn't match, then obviously there's been some tampering with the passport. And it only the border control officer can really access the information on the chip. So that's how St. Kitts, Island of Dominica, and there's a few other islands, that's how they're using our PKI. Jamaica and Barbados, they're using it to actually issue citizen IDs. So the national Jamaican ID will actually be issued using our technology. And as well to authenticate citizens as well to the Jamaican government online services. So that is a huge project. It's being implemented as we speak. It's not in production today, but it started because it's a massive project, but it is in the works. And then as well, I think it's Barbados. They too have gone with our cloud service, but it is for national ID as well. So some really, really interesting projects coming out of the Caribbean.
Thank you. Thank you for that, Dahlia. The next question, just before we proceed, because with the e-passport, you hinted towards the PKI solution. But earlier on, you mentioned also something about digital signing, right? Isn't that something that that PKI solution also covers?
Absolutely. So PKI can do the digital signing of documents. There's a difference between electronic signing and digital signing. Electronic signing does not require a certificate. And that's, you know, that's just an electronic image of a signature on a piece of paper. But a digital signature is signed with a certificate. And when you sign a document, a PDF document with a digital certificate, you know, it really, it's the same thing as an actual ink signature on a piece of paper. Yeah, there's non-repudiation on that electronic, on that digital signature. It's valid in a court of law. It basically, a digital signature proves that you have signed that document.